There you go. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us this evening at this Listen to Indigenous Voices opportunity to share ways in moving forward together based on everyone's experience over the months and even years with your experience of listening to Indigenous voices in your various community settings. So we look forward to hearing your experiences. And sharing ideas of any ideas of how you continue to work.
Sorry, Trevor, you're muted.
Have I been muted the whole time?
No.
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 Oh, okay.
Continue to work were your last words. Continue to work.
Okay. So we have with us to share their own unique experiences and share some ideas. Joan Melanson, who's from Holy Name Parish in Toronto, and she's going to kind of kick us off once we get to the sharing of our experiences part from their experiences at Holy Name. They've done a lot of interesting, they have a lot of interesting ideas. And then Monica Lambden from British Columbia is going to to help kind of conclude the evening with some ideas of going forward with the idea of listening to Indigenous Voices national network. We'll talk about that at the time. And we also have with us a special guest, Angela Boyer, who represents the Indigenous communities to accompany us in this reflection. And so Angela has worked with Joan Melanson at Holy Name Parish and accompanying them, and they're listening to Indigenous Voices reflections and activities. And I invite you, Angela, just kind of say a few words about yourself.
Majim Kans Kwadejna Kaz Mississaugi Donjaba Mayingan Endodem. My English name is Angela Boyer. My spirit name is Turtle Shell Woman, and I'm from Mississauga First Nation. And so thank you, first of all, for having me to be able to hold space with you tonight in these beautiful discussions. I got to participate in a circle with Joan, and it was very beautiful. Everything in life is about learning and letting go what you need to and healing. But I've been in my community. I left my First Nation when I was about 12 years old. I've been doing my work since then. And everything that would user learn or are speaking about is the work that I've been doing from a holistic standpoint. Working from the healers, working with the healers, from the education to missing and murdered Indigenous women, and then many different capacities. But I think you all know that in life, we will wear any hat that we need to in order to get the job done and also to walk in purpose in life. So Chimigwets once again for having me, and I look forward to hearing all of you.
Chimigwets, Angela. And Stan, I'd like to invite Stan to offer a gift to tobacco.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. My name is Stan Lebovalier. I work with Trevor. And Angela, let me check my video. Yeah. I'm on behalf of the Jesuit Forum and all of us present here tonight, I want to offer you this tobacco to thank you for your presence and for your guidance tonight. Thank you very much for being with us.
Chimigwech.
So as we continue at this point, let's begin with a land acknowledgement, and just take a moment to be mindful of, prayerfully mindful of the land upon which you are meeting us upon, from which you join us virtually. And for the Jesuit Forum, we acknowledge that the land we meet you upon is the traditional territory of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, and the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples. And they offered assistance to the early European travelers to this territory and shared their knowledge for survival in what was at times a harsh climate. This area of Toronto was also known as the Dish with One Spoon Wampum territory, which is a covenant treaty between the Haudenosaunee and the Anishinaabe peoples to care for the lands around the Great Lakes, to share the bounty and the gifts of the land in a way that is equitable and fair, taking no more than what one should. And we seek a new relationship in our acknowledgement with the original peoples of this land, upon all of our lands, one based upon honor and deep respect for one another's. And I just take a moment, and if you would like to share in the chat the lands upon which you join us. And as people are offering their land acknowledgements, I'll give a brief overview of how we'll spend our evening together. Just, we come with the sole purpose, we're not going to break up into small groups. Maybe we should, but that's not how we planned it, because we're a good group of people. Good amount of people, but really just to share with one another the richness of our history with listening to Indigenous voices, and how, what is it that drew you in the first place to listening to Indigenous voices, really ultimately towards truth and reconciliation among many ways through listening to Indigenous voices, the richness of your experience of that, and how you move forward, how you continue to be involved in truth and reconciliation based on that experience of LTIV. And really to answer the question for many people that who still have that question, what next? After listening to Indigenous voices, is that it? You know, is this the end? You know, how can we continue this journey to learn from one another? And then, so we will, someone sharing their screen. We will begin and shortly with Joan Melanson, and she'll offer a few of her experiences, her parish community's experiences for Holy Name. And then we'll ask Angela if she has any insights or comments, any advice. And then we'll open it up to your own experiences. And we'll just kind of go popcorn style in one group. So given our time, not everyone will have a chance, but we're here to share and to listen. And we'll see how that goes with almost 30 people. And then again, we invite Angela. Angela, feel free to come in at any point and offer any insights. You know, you're here to, we're grateful for your accompaniment. So, and then we'll hear from Monica about the idea of a LTIV national network, and then some informal sharing on that idea, you know, if that sounds appealing, any ideas around that, further ideas. And then we will conclude our evening at 8 o'clock Eastern time, Toronto time. So with that in mind, here I hand it over to Joan to kind of start us off in a sharing, rich sharing of ideas.
Thank you, Trevor. Can everybody hear me?
Mm-hmm.
I'm having trouble. Okay, good. Thank you. And Angela, I am so glad that you were able to join us this evening. So it's wonderful to see your face. I look forward to seeing you in person soon. Trevor, I thought I would talk about our experience at Holy Name and frame what I have to say around the questions that you asked us to think about coming to the meeting. So the first one was, you know, in what context and with which kind of group did you use the listening to Indigenous voices resource? So I started a Truth and Reconciliation group at Holy Name Parish in the East End of Toronto, the Danforth area, if you know the city, about 2.5 years ago. About 24 people from the parish showed up for our first meeting. I thought, you know, that's a pretty good turnout. And we met once a month, and I organized a facilitated workshop where we figured out a purpose statement to help us focus who we are, what we're doing, and what our goals would be as a group. And I'm happy to share that with anybody if you're interested in how that process went. I can fill you in on what we did and how it worked out. We also created a reading and video resource list for the entire parish. We put it in the, on the parish website, and we brainstormed different ways that we could approach learning. It's important to note, and not surprisingly, that there was a real range of knowledge that people had about Indigenous issues. Some people knew very, very little, actually. Some people knew more. But the one thing we all agreed on was that we all had a lot of learning to do. And so we don't meet monthly anymore, and I'm a little bit concerned about the fact that we may be losing momentum. And maybe that's not so surprising after more than 2 years. But there's just not the same level of engagement. And I have learned that in order to keep this going, at least one person has to lean in. And as it turns out, that person is me. So I'm committed. I've been doing a lot of community outreach. I've come up with ideas that are realistic and doable so that we can keep that momentum going as a group. And the response from the community has been tremendous, been very open and very, very supportive. So to that end, we've invited Indigenous elders to speak to our community. They've performed or conducted smudge ceremonies as part of the mass. They have participated in various church activities. For example, we invited some Indigenous artists from our neighborhood to come and sell their work at our church fairs. And that was just a really lovely, informal way, you know, for people to get to know each other. The thing is, we have had several parish priests, 3 in 3 years. So that's a lot of turnover. And I'll talk about that more in a minute. But we also, you know, our group started using the Listening to Indigenous Voices guidebook, and we held dialogue circles. And we had a group of about 10 to 12 people. Stan is one of those. And they are all in. We've completed all 11 sessions. And people are really anxious and keen to keep going. So we're at that stage now. So what next in terms of listening to Indigenous voices? What did I like about the dialogue circles? I liked how keen people were to participate. As I say, about 10 to 12 people all in showed up every month. We held them once a month. And now that we're finished, they're really keen to keep going in some way. And I think, you know, I think the success of that is due in large part to the guidebook itself. Incredible information in the book, really great discussion prompt questions. And the input from Indigenous people was incredibly valuable and helpful. So, you know, the other thing we did as a group was to make sure that we held the dialogue circles after Mass on Sunday. What that means is that we don't have to worry about people, oh, I don't know, I've got, you know, my schedule, blah, blah, blah. Instead of trying to fit it in to their already busy lives, they're already at Mass anyway. And so we would just conduct the circle after the Mass. A couple of people, I'll be honest, left our parish, largely because of the what happened, you know, with in Kamloops. And then we learned more and more and more about the Catholic Church and residential schools. Interestingly, they have stayed part of the group. They're not coming to Mass, but they are coming to the dialogue circles after the Mass. So I think that's kind of interesting. What was missing in that process? Well, I can't help but wish that more people had participated. And, you know, we did try a couple of different approaches. We did invite Indigenous people to come and participate in the circle. And the dynamic of the group, it turned out that people were more interested in giving the time to the Indigenous speaker. They wanted to hear more from them, and more than they would have otherwise if the person was participating with everybody else in the circle. So we kind of changed gears, and we kept the Indigenous speaker events separate from the dialogue circle events. Angela was with us for one of our dialogue circles, and people still talk about that, Angela, and what a beautiful experience it was. What came out of this process? What came out of this dialogue circle process is, without question, increased awareness, heightened awareness of the history of residential schools. But you know what? As importantly, more awareness that Indigenous peoples continue to be discriminated against in all kinds of systemic ways. People in our dialogue circle group and in our larger faith community are now much more aware of just how important land is and all of the issues around that for Indigenous people. I'm grateful for how open our community has been in their willingness to learn more, in their wonderful spirit of welcoming Indigenous guests, in their sensitivity in recognizing that many Indigenous people are not comfortable being inside a Roman Catholic church. One of the most poignant memories I have, if I may share it with you, is it was a Sunday where we're having the church fair after the Mass. So we had invited some artists from the neighborhood to sell their work. It was also a Mass where an Indigenous elder was going to do a smudge ceremony at the beginning of the Mass. So I had asked the artists as they were setting up in the church hall, I said, do you want to come up into the church for the Mass? And they went, thanks, but no thanks. And I said, okay, fair enough. But I said, we're going to be doing a smudge. We've got an Indigenous elder who's coming to do a smudge. And would you like to see that at least? And they went, oh, yes, of course. So here there were like six or eight of them, right? And they came up into the church, and I made sure that they got to the altar, to the front, so they could enjoy the full experience. And it was an incredibly emotional and powerful moment, I think, for everybody who was in the church that day. It was a day that I'll never forget, that's for sure. So I think the main thing, you know, is that we've made progress. We've made some progress in building relationships with Indigenous people in our city. There's a lot more to do, of course, and that's where we are now. So the other question, have you planned any other initiatives related to truth and reconciliation? We've had a few other initiatives since we finished the dialogue circles. We invited the retired head of community services for the community of Six Nations. Some of you may know where that is. It's about 2 hours from Toronto near Brantford. She came and spoke for on National Truth and Reconciliation Day in September of this year. Her name's Karen Hill. There was a great turnout, about 80 people from our parish stayed after Mass to hear her speak. And she very generously invited all of us to come and visit her community. So that's what we're going to try and get organized probably in the spring. We're also planning a group visit, hopefully guided by an Indigenous person, to the beautiful Spirit Garden that you may have heard about that opened in September here in Toronto in Nathan Phillips Square. It's an incredible, incredible destination, you know, and we'd like to do that as a group with Indigenous guidance. I invited Catholic journalist Michael Swan to come and speak to our community just last week. As some of you may know, he was a reporter and associate editor of the Catholic Register, not anymore. He covered the papal visit and wrote a piece earlier this year about how Catholics and Canadians generally responded to the Pope's use of the word genocide to describe what Canada and the church has committed against Indigenous people. So that was interesting. You know, a lot of people came, people were engaged, they had great questions. So it was really heartening to see the response to that event. I'm almost done. Okay. So one of the people in our group is a teacher in our Truth and Reconciliation group. And she was telling me about an exercise that she and other teachers did with guided over several sessions where they created a personal, actionable land acknowledgement. I thought, that's so interesting. You know, that's maybe something we could do as a group, so that we each have a very personal way of living out a land acknowledgement that has some meaning to us as individuals. So I'm really intrigued by that idea. How would you imagine a simple online space to hear about other facilitators' experiences? I think a website could do it. You know, there's a Facebook group called Catholics for Truth and Reconciliation that I'm part of, but not everybody uses Facebook. So whatever it is that we do, it would be great to exchange ideas, share resources, ideas, all of that, in a way that's accessible to everybody. Do you see other uses for listening circles? Absolutely. Our group would definitely be interested in learning more, and hopefully from that learning will come action. So I'm thinking, you know, maybe we could create additional sessions about contemporary Indigenous issues. And now we need some guidance from Indigenous people on what those issues should be. And we'd also have to get the resources to figure out how we would conduct those conversations, what the discussion questions would be, and so on. But I know in our community, there's a real appetite for continuing, if at all possible, those the dialogue circle conversations. Okay, I'm almost done now. In closing, I do feel that we've made progress, and I'm hopeful, I'm always hopeful, that we can continue to do so. One of the challenges, of course, is that people really do lead busy lives, and it's extremely difficult to get volunteers who have the time if there's any kind of research or preparation work involved. But, you know, we persist. Another challenge is that we must continue. It's challenging in Toronto, but we must continue to build relationships with Indigenous organizations. And that means establishing trust. And that's hard to do when you don't know each other. And it's especially hard to do when your group is connected with the Catholic Church. So one of my favorite expressions is, nevertheless, she persisted. And so that's what I'm doing. I'm persisting. So if you have questions, I am happy to answer them. I've talked long enough. I do thank you for listening, and I look forward to hearing from everybody else who's on this call today. Thank you, Trevor. Back to you.
Okay. Thank you so much, Joan, Shaven Gwich. Right on time. Perfect. Oh. I'm sure you could have gone on more, and people still would have been listening with open ears. I'm sure people are taking lots of notes as well, like I have. So thank you. You missed one thing, though. I was waiting.
What's that?
The children's group.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. Yes. Thank you, Trevor. Yeah, we have a children's program at Holy Name. Our new pastor doesn't like it and is talking about getting rid of it. And there's some real pushback about that, let me tell you. But they have been doing work complementary to our Truth and Reconciliation group. And whenever our dialogue circle would meet, a separate group of some children in the parish would go off and do an appropriate activity connected to the session that we were talking about. It was amazing. And some of the insights that those kids had were very powerful, not surprisingly. Yes, thanks for the reminder, Trevor. Yeah, that was a big part of what we did.
And, you know, and maybe like in some form, like through a Facebook group or whatnot, once we get ideas going, you can share a little more details of how you, I know it was Vanessa who was really instrumental in creating those things. And so, yeah.
She facilitated it. She's with her kids and some other children from parish families.
And she even invited her older boy to sit on her local dialogue circle that we had online. And he was
good.
10 at the time, and he really got a lot from it. So
yeah, that's great. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Joan.
No, it was my pleasure.
Angela,
thank you.
I invite you, if you'd like, because I know you've been at Holy Names, so you have a bit of personal experience with a lot of what Joan has revealed. So maybe if you'd like to share any thoughts of your own experiences.
I do want to listen to everyone's ideas, but I think just hearing the children piece, I think that's the piece. We all matter. We all have gifts, we all have strengths. That comes in our family lineage, that comes in our blood memory of our families, and we all come from Mother Earth before anything else. That's our true mother. And I think that's the lens that we always have to look from, because a lot of the times we look from differences and things like this. And when we think about giving back, because me and Joan have had some conversations, and money is good. Yes, money is great, but that's not the fixer in this moment. When you think of land acknowledgement, and again, I only can speak for myself. I can't speak for everyone, because everyone's so different how they carry themselves as an Indigenous person, their lived experience, and everything that they've gone through. I have to say that I'm a little bit more open. I'm a little bit, I like to hear, and my responsibility, if I haven't let yous know, is I'm turtle shell woman. So my responsibility and purpose here in this life is the unity of brothers and sisters of Mother Earth. And so with the children, when I hear that, sorry, my nephew's here. sorry. He's in the room with my daughter. But the children, when I got excited hearing that, is because that's where we need to lay the seeds. That's where they're going to grow. That's where cycles are going to be broken. And us as adults, yes, we're there. We all have gifts. We all want to give back. But I hear, and I'm going to be very quick, is that we did a lot of reading. We did a lot of listening. Now it's time to create action. Now it's time to create connection. And that means sharing our gifts amongst each other. But I'm going to listen in, and I'm just going to see what he needs. But I look forward to hearing everybody.
Thank you, Angela. So now we open it up to all of you. Joan has set us off on a wonderful path, the spirit in which we hoped we would be established for this evening, of sharing your own ideas. And there are the questions that, you know, that are suggested of guiding your sharing, but feel free to, you know, share in any way you like. So the floor is open. And remember, please, to, how do we do this? Now, maybe rather than people speaking over one another, Victor or Stan, would you mind moderating? And if you'd like to speak, put it, kind of the typical Zoom sort of protocol, put up your digital hand, and then maybe that's a better moderation than just a verbal sort of insertion. And it could be, you know, responding to Joan's ideas, maybe asking a little more detail. But we do want to hear ideas from others as well. So, and Angela, I invite you to come in at any time as well. No, don't wait for an invitation from me.
Karen has raised her hand. Maybe she can speak.
Thank you. I'll start us off. Maura McGrath is here too, and she was in our group, so Maura might add. Okay. So we use the Listening to Indigenous Voices. We offered our sisters and associates across English-speaking Canada who would like a book, and we ordered them. And this was 2021, so still kind of pandemic time. So some groups that were close together met in small groups, but we did one large group across Canada once a month in the evening. And we had maybe 60 of our sisters and associates who signed up. And so for the 12 months we met, and we had an elder with us each month that, and it was Maura and I coordinated, I see Maura there now. So we had an elder, and it was a different elder each month. And as on our last month, one of our sisters who's like 91 said, "So now what are we going to do? What are we doing next?" And so somewhere in there, I think we did the virtual blanket exercise too. So then we did Home on Native Land, which is an online program, which was good, but not nearly as good as listening to Indigenous voices. We were really glad that we had started with that one. And it was neat to hear and see the changes in the participants. And one sister said, "We're being converted," which was a very cool expression and a very true one. So we finished Home on Native Land in October. And again, we had an elder with us each month that we met. And so then we set into place blanket exercises. So we had two in the West. We just did one in Kingston last week, in-person blanket exercises. We did one in Halifax yesterday. Toronto is this weekend, and Charlottetown is next week, and Montreal will be the week after. And in many of those places, we're doing them in parish halls, or where we've invited like CWL Parish Council to join us. And the neat piece of the last two was kind of like we heard then the CWL and Parish Council who hadn't been involved saying, "We need to do this in our parish." Maura, is there anything you want to add there? I think that's enough for me.
No, that's great. And I just apologize, Joan, because I came late, so I missed some of what you're saying. But for us, sisters and associates from PEI to British Columbia, it was a very, very meaningful experience. And I think, as Karen says, we're going to continue in some way. We're continuing with the blanket exercise. But we're on a journey, and we're not going to get off the road, I think. And we certainly need to be converted. And as Karen said, having an elder with us, and at first, maybe for about a year, it was a different person each time, and we had to kind of search that out. And then it was one person for the next year. That was key. That was absolutely so important to us. So, it's like what Murray Sinclair said, education is what got us here, and education is what's going to get us out of this. So, it just feels very positive, like in all that's happening, this is a positive step, responding to a call to truth and reconciliation. So, and Karen and I did really well, she in Halifax and me in Montreal. And I guess another thing too, there are such different levels of consciousness. Like we had some people who perhaps were very, very unaware, and others who very aware. And that's challenging, but it was good.
And some who were resistant.
Yeah, some push back, okay? Mm-hmm.
And we did use the book, and we used the suggested questions like at the end, and that's how we did the circles, because both Maura and I did the initial training with you. And it really opened up the conversation. Then we came back to the large group, and then people shared not a report from the small groups, the breakout rooms, but more it was what touched them, what challenged them, what changed them.
Yeah, yeah. And the book, honestly, what a treasure. I mean, if I had my wish, we would do it again, you know? Mm-hmm. Really.
And we've given many as gifts to other, like bishops. Uh-huh. Yeah. People that we think need to have them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We even invited the bishop here to the blanket exercise yesterday, but he didn't come. But he was happy to get the book, so one out of two.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Maura and Karen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Greg Diaz is next.
Hi, everyone. So the first session that I attended was when you first started with this listening to Indigenous voices. I ended up ordering the book. I actually ordered several copies because that was an amazing booklet that was put together, extremely informative. But before that, I had formed a group called MIA, Movement for Active Indigenous advocacy and allyship. So we're just a grassroots organization, not registered or anything. And we just reached out to as many people, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous, to get advice as to what we can do. And so we focused on initiatives rather than meeting and discussing, what was in listening to Indigenous voices. We did that in the beginning, and then we thought we'd like to move on and take action. So we connected with the Treaty 3 police in Northwestern Ontario, and we did like a sports and wellness drive. We've connected with other organizations like True North Aid. We've got some funding. We realized that food was a big issue. We were hoping to do something in housing, but it was easier for us to get involved with food security. So I connected with Nunavut, the food charity up in Iqaluit, and then got funding through True North Aid. So we've been shipping much needed food items. As you can imagine, it's one of the most food insecure territories or provinces, in Canada. And it's the longest standing, I guess, health emergency issue in Canada. So I'm happy to say that through that initiative, we've shipped over 4,000 kilos of food. We connected with Mississauga Food Banks Mississauga. They recently agreed to help with shipping some of the stuff, but we got funding for the transportation. As you can imagine, that costs a lot of money. We have no funding of our own. As I said, we are not a registered charity, but we thought we'd really focus more on just connecting directly. Hasn't always been easy. Some communities, actually, we did even try to connect with Mississaugas of First Nation. I mean, Mississauga Nation, sorry, the six communities. And I think we were pretty green at that time and didn't know what to offer, so we didn't get too far. But we've participated in powwows, and that has helped us make more connections. And I would highly recommend taking part in the powwows for any communities. Native Child and Family Services was the most recent one. So we've connected with them and do a lot of collaboration when it comes to food in that area. So I'm going to stop because I could go on. So thank you for listening. And thank you, Joan and Angela, for what you've shared. I got a lot out of it. And I will sign off with that.
Thank you very much, Greg. And Teresa is next.
You're welcome.
Did you say Teresa's next?
Yes,
Yeah.
exactly.
Okay, thank you. So I'm in southern Alberta, and after doing the facilitator's coursework, I ran a study through our church, which is the Roman Catholic Women Priests, and we had about 26 people online from BC to Ontario attend. And as well, in our living room, we had 8 people coming together. So we were together on screen for the beginning, the introduction, the first night of introducing ourselves as our grandmothers, our grandparents, land acknowledgement and where we've come from. And then we had 4 facilitators. So we split the group online into 4 groups, and we had the living room group, and I provided a facilitator sheet for them to speak one at a time in the circle format. And that ran in the springtime of 2023 from February through till May, weekly. So every week coming together. And then in the fall, we ran it again so that people online who had missed some sessions could just come if they wanted to. And a new group of people, there were about 8 who signed up that time. And within our community now at Mass, we always begin with a land acknowledgement. We've chosen water first as a place to donate funds. And the awareness of Indigenous people. The last group, we invited a local Blackfoot woman to speak about her, whatever she wanted to speak about, and she came with her husband and they led the prayer for us, and they're members of our community as well now. So I think that in terms of using it elsewhere, we also ran a study of the Book of Ruth on border crossing and immigrants, and we used the style of the circle in order to just facilitate people being listened to, and found it very powerful. A lot of people, that was the first time they'd experienced such orderly listening. I think in the beginning it was important to debrief after and just see how each of the groups had gone. And generally, people wanted to tell others about it. And so I've also been giving out books to young people, university students doing courses, other people's doing grad work in Indigenous studies, just offering it. In my homilies, I often will use quotes from this book. And I do work for L'Arche Canada, and they also are now, through my sessions, being introduced to land acknowledgements as well in their sessions. So, thank you.
Thank you, Teresa, and everyone. Maybe before we, if there's any other, but if there's any comments, insights on what we have heard so far, before we move forward a bit, let's just kind of pause from what we heard so far, so we're not too overwhelmed. Any resonances? Gail, I think, had her hand up. You're muted, Gail.
Trevor, I believe it's Sylvia who has her hand up.
Yeah, I think she's, I assume Sylvia is going to share further on her own, but we're just going to pause here from what we've heard so far before we move forward. I don't know if that makes sense.
Okay, sorry about that. I apologize. but I love everybody's ideas. You know, it takes that action to go with the words and the reading and to learn more. And so I was always told from Grandmother Renee, because I've been kind of mentored by many of the grandmothers in the community, and she likes to always tell us that we're like seed layers. We lay our seeds in, and we allow, if it's meant to grow, it's going to grow, and if it's not, it's not. And through our conversations with Joan, I've always told her about like the connection. And so going through your Indigenous voices, we know what the history is. We know that there was a lot of hardships. There was a lot of traumas. There was many things there, but we are where we are right now. And it's time to create that change and break the cycles, because we, in life, we're about cycles in all of us, not just Indigenous, in every human being. We have family cycles. And one of the big things is, through residential school, we lost our language and our culture. And that's the biggest thing, that truth and reconciliation for me as a younger woman working for a community, most likely until my last breath, is you want to give back, then it's time for us to give back. And it begins with children as well, because we want to, in order to, for us to bring back the culture and the language of what was, it's giving the children their culture back. And that's through not everybody's culture, not everybody's ceremony, not everybody walks this path, and some are still church, and that's okay too. Everybody needs to have faith, and everybody needs to believe in something. But I think that key, and I was always trying to connect Joan to one of the lodge keepers here who I go to ceremony with. And I think it's important to experience that ceremony to understand it. We do, I just completed my 4-day fast. They do Sundance ceremony. They do equinoxes. So Christmas, winter is coming up, so they're going to be doing ceremony then. And that's where, for me, working in our community in the holistic field, being a helper to many of the healers and knowledge keepers, many of our people, it's they're seeking their identity, right? Because something was taken away from them from a deeper lineage, and they're trying to find out where they belong. And if they're not on their First Nations, and they've been dispersed or maybe had to come to a city, sometimes coming to a city, you can get lost because you don't have your village, you don't have your people, you don't have your roots. And we all have gifts and we all have strengths. And that's why I always say, when you're doing this work, you have to reflect upon yourself deeply because you have the gifts within you to give back. You know, the leaders above, it makes me sad when I heard that the above doesn't want to, but we don't, respectfully, I say this, we don't need them to create the change. We need each and every one of you, because each and every one of you went through some hardship, overcame something. And that's the stories we also need to hear, because if you can get over it and we can uplift each other and empower each other with the gifts and strengths. And it was also maybe you're IT, maybe you're a math, maybe you're English, maybe you're writing. These are gifts to share, because a lot of our community has issues too with learning styles and things like this. So there's so many ideas to do, but it all starts individually because it's your own story, your own connection, and it's also that land acknowledgement. When I heard Joan talk about that personal land acknowledgement, that is taking reflection on you and where you come from. What's your own land acknowledgement? And what is the connection to this land that you sit on today? And I think everything is reflection and everything that you bring forward. So, but I love to hear that yous are giving back. I love to hear that yous are creating connection. And one thing, though, I do want to just lay my seeds with today, is that when we're working with Indigenous community, because it's becoming an issue in our community, and yous might be aware of this through social media, is that there's a pretendian issue. So when and that's something part of the truth and reconciliation, is to really be careful who you hire and make sure that the lineage is there, because we have many people taking the spots of Indigenous people that shouldn't be holding those spots. So I just wanted to lay that with you, but I think all of yous are doing an amazing job, and it's time for action and connection, and for us to be human to human together. And you know, we need the grandmothers to step forward with their knowledge, the aunties and uncles and the grandfathers, and the children are the most important, because they're the ones who are ultimately going to change our world for our future, for a better world.
Which, Angela, thank you. And so maybe we'll move forward then with further ideas and thoughts. And then, and Angela, feel free to continue. Sylvia.
Hi, I'm a part of something called the Toronto Justice Circle. I think we've been meeting for about 15 years with people who have been very involved in many justice issues. And in fact, one of the founders of the group was one of the writers of the book too, Listening to Indigenous Voices. So when it came out, we certainly watched the launch, and then as a group, we did this. It took us 2 years to go through because we meet monthly, but there are other issues that we deal with. So we did eventually get through all of the chapters, and certainly could have, done it in much more depth, but then at the end of it, there was a sense of, well, what do we do next? And so what we did a year ago in September, we went to a place at Six Nations that's called Chiefswood. And it's kind of like a park-like setting. There are lofts and places that you can stay at. There's all kinds of recreation things on that property. There's a big meeting hall, and but they also will program for you as well too. So they set up a 2.5 day program for us. It's on the property that Pauline Johnson's farm once was on too, right? So we did a variety of things, starting off with kayaking or canoeing on the river that flows through it. Forget the name of it. But one of the things that we a few of the things that we did, there is a nursery that's a native plant nursery. And in fact, they're doing some work at the Leslie Spit to restore native plants, right? And so we and they have a federal grant in order to grow native plants. And then they go out to different places and plant or landscape, or you can buy plants right there. So that was very interesting. But another thing we ended up doing is going to a place right in Brantford called the Woodland Cultural Center, an excellent, excellent kind of museum. It's right beside the old residential school that's being restored. So actually, we were able to go into the girls' section of the residential school. Just a very horrific and powerful expression. It's not open yet, but they again explained a lot to us. And because we had to rush through the Woodland Cultural Center, we ended up going back this spring and were there for quite a while. Plus, they're on that. In the Six Nations, right beside the Woodland Cultural Center, there's also a bookstore that is an amazing, amazing Indigenous bookstore with everything from babies' books to, to what you would see in other bookstores, except they're Indigenous. Some of them are in the languages and so on, right? So that was a really incredible find. And it's only because the Toronto Star had an article about cheesewood that we actually ended up going there. So I'd highly recommend it if you are in the Toronto area to go to cheesewood and to have them do a program for you. I mean, we didn't do everything that they would have liked us to do, but it was great. So, and since that time, I mean, we do other issues, and we have been spending some time on the Palestinian issue. But I just wanted to say that 2 weeks ago, Francesca Albanese was in Toronto. She's the UN Special Rapporteur on Palestine. And she, so I was in a meeting where she was speaking, and she had just come from a 2-hour meeting with Indigenous peoples. And she said, completely tied the two in, right? And said, the genocide that's going on in Palestine, there was obviously there was a genocide of Indigenous peoples in Canada, and it's an ongoing genocide. She introduced Sylvia McGrath, I think that's her name, who's written a piece in the book as well too. She came up and spoke. So I have a lot more to say, but right now I've just finished reading a book by Negan Sinclair, because I also live in Thunder Bay. I li live in Whitby, but I live in Thunder Bay, and he was just there on a book tour of his book. Sylvia McAdam, sorry. Yeah. And his book is called Winnipeg, which is the Indigenous way of saying Winnipeg. And he's a prof, but he also, and the son of Murray Sinclair, but he's also a journalist for the Winnipeg Free Press and writes a column. And so he's put a lot of these columns together, and they're short, but they and he's got an incredible sense of humor, but there's a real punch to it as well too. So I highly recommend that book, and we continue, our group continues this year. I think we're going to be reading Murray Sinclair's newest book and talking about it. So I can speak a lot more because I've also done things with Trevor at the Anishinaabe Center, but I won't go any further.
Thank you very much, Sylvia. Anne, I think you wanted to talk.
Thank you, Stan. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm in, I live on unceded Musqueam territory here in Richmond, BC. And I've been facilitating the Listening to Indigenous Voices I've done three circles now, starting 2022, 23, and 24, about every 3 to 4 weeks, starting January, finishing in November, taking breaks for school holidays. And the first circle I did in 22 was an ecumenical circle, with about 25 people from different Christian traditions and a few that are sort of on the edge of the Catholic tradition, and very rich conversations. And then the second two circles were through the local Catholic church here, which had had some blanket exercises as well. So this was their next step. And I've participated in one way back as a participant. So even after four times being part of these circles, it's enriching every time, as some of you probably have discovered. Every time it goes deeper and richer, different people, different conversations, different perspectives. So that's been a positive. It's just the numbers are declining. So that's a challenge, like maintaining a level so you have enough people in a circle. The other thing, I also co-facilitate blanket exercises with my sister, who is Musqueam-Layak-Tsin-Snanawis, my adopted sister. So we are doing blanket exercises, and I wanted you to speak about the children because we've been in many Catholic schools with grade 4, grade 9, and grade 11. And my preference is to work with children because they're so open. They're very thoughtful. They're really listening. And they're like today, we were with a group of 40 grade 4s at St. Mary's in Vancouver. And the questions, when we go in the small circles, like, what do you wonder about? Why did they take the land? Why did the Europeans take the land? Why didn't they just share it? How did they take the land? And I say, hold on to that question. Keep asking that question. And we're planting seeds. So last year we were with 400 students between grades 4 and 11. So I think these are seeds, as Angela was saying, these are seeds that are being scattered and planted, and hopefully we tell them, you're the change makers. We count on you. You're the change maker. The other last thing I was going to say was, I'm in the midst of reading Marie Sinclair's book, Who We Are. And Angela touched on these questions, like, where do I come from? Where am I going? Why am I here? Who am I? These four questions for life and for a nation. And one of a few of the people in the last circle that I did with listening to Indigenous voices is said, why don't you start a book study with this book? It's such an incredible book. He is so wise and he tells a lot of stories and it really helps in understanding. And the only other thing to say was all the circles I've done are online with listening to Indigenous voices, because I started doing it sort of still coming out of pandemic. So I developed a PowerPoint and I've added some local BC First Nations material that I use in the session to supplement the manual and the online program to just round it out to give a flavor of British Columbia as well. Because there's some unique things about British Columbia in terms of treaties and some of the history. So yeah, I've got this great PowerPoint that I've used and I keep massaging it and working on it. So it works really well. It is possible to create a reflective dialogue online. That's what I've learned and people have appreciated that. So sorry to take so long.
Thank you so much, Anne. If I could just say a few words before we continue. And the idea is that we would conclude this session at around 7:15, give or take, and then we'll move on. But I just want to, maybe I could say a few words that I thought about that I have done, that I've helped, not that I've done, but I've helped facilitate in the circles that I've Our Lady of Lourdes. And one thing we did was, after our Listen to Indigenous Voices Circle series, we went to the Kent Monkman exhibit at the Royal Ontario Museum. And we went together, and then we went back to the Jesuit Forum offices, because it's only a block away from the ROM. And we had a discussion on this very rich, provocative Indigenous art, you know. It was very enriching. So it's a cultural experience. And, you know, these are other ways of going, you know, hearing of going to the Woodland Cultural Center, going to powwows, going, like really going to accepting the invitation of what Indigenous peoples has to offer in your local communities, whether it's art, cultural events, you know, and also the books. You know, one of the things that we're looking at as a Jesuit forum is starting a book club. You know, and we're looking at Murray Sinclair's memoirs, but also Nigan Sinclair's as well. Who do we begin with? But there's such a, you know, and just we may have a few people, and we'll break it up into maybe 3 or 4 sessions, and then just. It's another way of coming together in a listening to Indigenous voices style, but with a new material, quote unquote, you know. So it's part of the educational aspect of related to calls to action. And just one more thing, we had a film series as well, Indigenous film series. We showed Alanis Obomsawin, a couple films of hers. And they're easy because they're on the National Film Board of Canada. So, you know, for public showing, they're easy to show. Sorry, I didn't mean to interject here, but I guess that's the taking advantage of my host position. I guess that. But I did want to someone had put I don't want to name, but we're hearing lots of hope, curiosity, and interest, but it's not consistent across the board. And I'm just, if that person would like to maybe expand on that and maybe, you know, has it all, you know, we're talking a lot about very rich experiences, but where are the struggles? What's like, yeah. So, Murray.
That comment was mine. And just to set it in context, I'm the adult faith animator for the Simcoe Muskoka Catholic District School Board. So our area, which includes the Martyr Shrine and St. Marie Among the Hurons. So we are in some ways kind of ground zero for where European Catholic society and Indigenous cultures collided in the 1600s in this part of Ontario. And that's provoked all kinds of really challenging, interesting conversations with the Jesuit community there. You know, we've been in dialogue with them over the last 6 or 7 years. When the book first came out, I ordered a stack of it for all of our senior board leaders, for our trustees, for our superintendents. And I, in a way that I hear echoing across, there was lots of enthusiasm at the beginning. We got through about the first 4 chapters, and then interest started to wane and people got busy, and it was harder and harder to bring people back to those conversations. And that, so we've kind of had to press pause. And there are some people who just say, well, we've done that. We've moved on now. You know, the Pope has been here. He said what he needed to say. We're moving on to the next thing now. And people don't, a lot of people don't have a sense that this is going to be a generational, you know, decades long journey. A lot of people just think that it's a checkbox. So yeah, we've done that. Now we move on to the next thing. It's taken care of. And there isn't a sense of the trauma that's involved and the impact, the generational, intergenerational impact of the residential schools and of colonization on communities. We have 4 First Nations whose students attend our schools. We have learning agreements with 4 of them. And we have a number of resource, Indigenous resource teachers who come and work in our schools, and grad coaches who work with our students of Indigenous ancestry. And I co-chair our Truth and Reconciliation committee for our board with our Indigenous lead, Linda McGregor. So there's a small little group of people, about a dozen, who are very, very interested and very passionate and want more information and want to go further. And then there's people who are, you know, kind of arm's length from that, who are kind of curious, not quite sure, it's rocking the boat for some of them, and it's making people uncomfortable, and so people kind of step back. So the material is excellent. It's provocative. It's beautifully presented. It's really sparking good conversation for those who are open to it. But a lot of people just feel like this is yesterday's news, and they're moved on to the next thing. And that was 4 or 5 years ago, and now we go on to something else. So trying to keep up the momentum, trying to keep up the interest, trying to remind people that this is not a one and done kind of thing. And even if we go through all of the sessions, that's not reconciliation. We haven't finished the work of truth and reconciliation. So that was kind of the context for my comment. So thank you.
Thank you, Murray. If I could just before we move on, Angela, would you have anything to, not to put you on the spot, but
Yes, I did because I'm hearing you, and my mind's like things pop in it. And so I'm hearing, I think that reflection of who I am, where am I going, what's my purpose needs to be done with each of you individually, because that's how you're showing up in this space. And then once you do this work for you, because people are resistant because they don't understand, they're going to feel uncomfortable, they don't know how to be in this space, how are they connected to this space? Sometimes there's just, again, the cycles of ignorance and a certain way of looking at things. And that's okay because if that's the way they're going to live their life, and if those 12 people show up, that's the one that's going to grow, that's going to have that ripple effect in that water, right? Those ripples are just going to continue because whoever they touch, speak to, enlighten, it's going to continue. But the next thing I think about, because I think some brainstorms need to happen. And the reason why I say this is because we have the literature, we read it, the histories, the hardships. But what is the revitalization of each? How do each of you see giving back? What does that look like to each of you? So because I'm a ceremonial person, and I know that culture and ceremony brings you connection to your creator. And creator, having a connection gives you peace within yourself. And I think going through your book now and doing like, so what was taken away? The language. Let's use that as a starting point. How can we bring that back? How can we help support the Indigenous people in this component? Ceremony. Ceremony was the identity of who we were, and that was taken away. And there was many sacred passages from the naming ceremony. That's the baby's purpose. My name's Turtle Shell Woman. That ceremony's not given a lot, and it's hard in between. But to be able to give that back to a child, can you imagine how you would feel to know that that little baby has its name, has its purpose, and it is not going to, because as you, when you have your spirit name, you start to, as you grow up, you're like, yes, I'm Turtle Shell Woman. I don't know what it means, but as you get older, you start to reflect, and you've actually been doing that work because the ancestors always knew what your purpose down here would be. Then we get into all the different passages. That maybe if they want to dance in the powwow wasn't really ours. Like that wasn't really. It's something more modern, but it's a place for connection. There's the fasting ceremony. There's the sundance ceremony. There's all these different ceremonies. And if you can have a piece of bringing back that to the children and allowing them to have their spirit name, maybe use our gifters of sewing. Let's get the kids teaching them how to sew so they can make their own regalias and their own traditional clothes. Maybe we have some people who the grandmothers, we lost a lot of the life skills. The jarring, all these skills, these are what we need to bring back. It's not only culture, it's just the love of a life skill, because now we got to bring these back. We have to bring these back, not only for Indigenous people, but across the board, right? But doing these little activities bring connection, brings new relationships to one another. And I think we're in a place that I just think really a self-reflection for each of you, of who you are, what's what your why, what is your why? And that's a hard question. What is your why? And who am I? That's a hard question to answer, because people are like, they use their titles. Well, I'm a lawyer. I'm a father, but you're much more than these things. Everyone needs to deep a little deeper inside. Like, who were your ancestors? What did they carry? What did they do? Right? So these are the things that you have to pull out in order to really come forward to understand this work that you're doing as well. Just a little thing, but I think brainstorming and really building off those ideas and sharing them amongst each other, your brainstorms, because then it just becomes a big, huge map that you can take. So I'll give an example. Yes, I'm Indigenous. And any of the work that I do, such as this engagement or any engagements I do, it's not for the benefit of myself. It's always, I usually always, I do speaking in different places. They want to sometimes give me an honorarium. And I give that back to ceremony, because my ceremonial family, I know that when I go into ceremony and I complete something, how connected, how proud I am to be Indigenous. And this is how my ancestors, that's how it was for them, right? And so I always give back, whether that's food, if we're prepping for fasting, we have to take bundles, and sometimes people can't afford their bundles. So I start to get them the materials. My daughters, I'm teaching them, you're going to do this. If people want to see you dance in your traditional clothes, the money's not for you. You have to give it back forward. That's how you create change. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Angela. Maybe we'll just have one more for this segment, and then we'll move forward. Maureen.
Thank you. And thank you for your thoughts, Angela. Very inspiring. I just wanted to comment back at some of what I heard from Murray was some of the fatigue, maybe, or the lessening of interest. So we've had three rounds of the Listening to Indigenous Voices series, started in 2022, then again in 23 and 24, and we did it every second week. And also I made sure that I let people know, I know you're all busy, so if you miss a session, they kind of stand alone, you know, you can still come into the next chapter, and it's not like you're way behind in anything. And so I did find that some people weren't always able to attend, and they would come into the next session anyway. I also found that some of them came back to the next whole group of sessions for the ones that they had missed from the previous round. So, but this fall, instead of offering Listening to Indigenous Voices, we thought we would try this Anglican program, Doctrine of Discovery, Stolen Land, Strong Hearts. I don't know if anyone has seen that one. We didn't use their format. They have it's all online and it's free, and it's a powerful presentation. And they do have a study guide for it. But one of our problems is we're finding that people don't have a big block of time to keep coming back. So we put the Doctrine of Discovery program into four sessions, which was a little crammed, but we got new people. We got some that were really wanting and interested, but not able to commit to a larger program. And it was just a way of trying to build more interest again and get started again. And then I think we'll go back to listening to Indigenous voices. We're trying to decide how to draw more people in. And we did advertise on the diocesan website. I'm not sure that we really got anybody from there. It was more like word of mouth. So we have a lot of people coming in that aren't necessarily part of our parish. But we'll just keep going with it. We do have a Truth and Reconciliation Committee that is broader. We do other things as well as education, but I'm part of the educational push. So that's how we've been proceeding. Thank you.
Thank you, Maureen. Thank you, everyone, for your sharing. And I know we never heard from everyone, and we couldn't expect that. But an evening such as this, a gathering such as this, is really just, we hope, just the beginning of coming together in this way and sharing and sharing ideas and around the question of what next. And so we're going to focus on that now in terms of an organizational, how we can continue to go together down this path. So I'm just looking at the, yes. So Monica, I'll hand it over to Monica, and she's going to share an idea that she had. And Monica and I have been talking, and how, yes, I'll just leave it up to that. And the beginning of this, this conversation on looking forward as a possible broader LTIV community. So Monica, and you're going to, I think you can share the screen. Okay. I think she has some slides. So.
Yes, thanks, Trevor. Hi, everybody. I'm Monica Lampton, and I'm living here in Vancouver on Musqueam territory. I have only been here for a few years. Before that, I was in Montreal for 20 years and in Ontario and Quebec. I first discovered listening to Indigenous voices when I was in Quebec, and I did a program through a friend of mine who's on this call, Kim, who has been doing some programs in Montreal around listening to Indigenous voices. So very grateful for that opportunity. And so when I came out to Vancouver, I wanted to get to know some people in my new parish, but I also had heard just by being present that people were very keen on making connections with Musqueam community, who's very close by, and just in general looking at the TRC and seeing what we could do, but nothing was really on hold. So I had proposed that we do this Listening to Indigenous Voices program, which we did. We did it every second week. So it took us about 10 months to do it because we also took breaks for school breaks and things like that. But we met in person every second week. And we always said as a group that this would be kind of step one. And then when we finished the program, we would look at what's next. And so when we got towards the end of the program, we started talking a little bit more about what's next. And we realized it would be very, very helpful to hear if other groups had taken next steps. You know, there was some talk about doing the program again in our parish. So we wanted to know, have other parishes done that? And some of that, or what about doing it ecumenically, or what about doing it at the diocesan level? Or there was all kinds of questions that we had. And so I started just reaching out through my own informal network across the country, because I had roots in Ontario and Quebec, but also my new network in BC, and then through contacts through the people I first reached out to. We ended up gathering together kind of an informal group of people who met on Zoom last February and started this idea. And some of you were here tonight, so thank you very much for responding to this invitation as well and coming here today. But the idea was, wouldn't it be great if we had a way to come together and support each other and swap ideas and share resources maybe, and all that kind of stuff. And one of the questions that we had for our area was reaching out to elders and wanting to be aware of what other parishes or has the diocese reached out to certain elders, and being sensitive to that and coordinating that and not putting kind of the burden on elders to respond to each separate invitation, but maybe take the responsibility ourselves to be a little bit more organized. So those were all the things that kind of inspired us. And then at some point, Trevor had heard about our network, and we ended up having a conversation, and he asked if the forum, you know, if I thought the forum could play a role in any way. And I think it's a great idea. It's a forum resource. And I think personally, if the forum can have some kind of a lead like they did for today's session in putting something together for us, then we'll reach more people because people find the resource through the forum. And so if you're already connected with the forum somehow, maybe you're you'll find follow-up or extended resources and things like that online. So that's a little bit of background to why I'm here and how this all came about. But I did put together a few slides to share from my experience with the group that we did, and also from the first network meeting that we had. I just thought it would be helpful maybe for people to be able to follow along in writing as well. And then maybe we could share them afterwards as well if people found them helpful, because they're mostly just lists of things that came up. Just starting with my personal group, at the end, we did kind of a wrap up where we went around in a circle format, like as if it was one of the questions for the session, and shared kind of how we saw the process that we did, and what about this experience of doing listening to Indigenous voices do we want to hang on to for whatever came next? What were some of our insights? What were our learnings? And so one was, and a lot of these I've heard here tonight already, so I'm not going to go into them in depth, but people talked about how this is ongoing learning. And that connects with number four on the list, which is, this is not one and done. And I heard that exact phrase by one of you earlier. People really liked the idea that the kind of the goal or the context of the sessions was, it was meant to be transformative. This is not necessarily just taking information in, but really what is happening to us as individuals, and what is happening to us as a group. It is something that we need to do together. It is something that it's important to connect to our faith, and we all have a role to play. And that came out of some reflection that we did have a core group that met every 2 weeks, but we did also have some people that were dropping in and out for various reasons, scheduling, you know, whatever. But every time someone joined us, there was always a richness about that. So there was this reflection that going forward, we wanted to keep it, that have that flexibility, so that whoever felt called to join us at whatever time would be welcome. So then we had a network meeting on Zoom in February, and we had about 20 people, and everybody from that meeting, and there were quite a few people who are on kind of the list as well, but who weren't able to make that particular meeting. And out of the people who were at the meeting, everybody said they wanted to share their emails and go forward and maybe meet again. And then out of the people who were kind of on the list that couldn't make the meeting but read the notes and everything, almost all of them as well said that they wanted to share their emails and move forward. And then I went on an extended trip, and while I was away, that's when Trevor contacted me and said, "Hey, I heard you had this meeting." So I just messaged everybody from that had been at this meeting or interested in it and said, "Let's put this on pause and see what can happen as we connect with the forum." And so here we are today. So these are the five main things that came out of that meeting that we had last February. Questions, really. It was a chance for us just to introduce ourselves and tell our stories, like kind of like we were doing here today, how we did the programs, how many times have we done it. And then we had a round of just naming what questions or concerns or what were we looking for by coming to this gathering. So these were kind of the five top categories. How to recruit for participants was a big one. And there was a lot of discussion about, do we stick with our own parish? Do we open it up to other parishes? What are the pros and cons of that? We talked about looking for the best format. So people shared, they met every week, every 2 weeks. Some people did the whole guide. Most of us did the whole guide, but some people just did a few sessions. Sticking to the program, that was a big one. And that is something that I personally think I would like to see us discuss and reflect on and explore a bit more. When I did Listening to Indigenous Voices circle for the first time, it was the second time I had done a circle. I had also done the, I think it was the Laudato Si one as well. And personally, I am feel that the process that's laid out is very, very enriching and kind of integral to the idea of transformation that we saw in one of my previous slides. And so I would like to hear from other people about their experiences around that and, see if there are modifications, kind of what's helpful, what's not helpful, etc. So we had a lot of discussion that night in February, but we really did say that this is to be revisited. So, you know, some people, as we heard here today, some people invited Indigenous speakers to come to their to the circle. Some people had Indigenous members of the circle. There was some changes to formats of discussion. There was, you know, different things like that done. What next when the program is complete? So that's kind of what we're all about today, and looking at a network. But that was also, we also had some good discussion about that last February, and people talked about a lot of the similar things that you all are talking about: having a speaker come to the parish, having a film, having a book club, going to an event, going to a powwow together, doing liturgical things together, doing action, taking action. All these kinds of things were covered, but we all said that we really wanted to talk more about it. It was one of the big things that brought us together and that motivated us to keep meeting together. And for us on the West Coast in the Vancouver region, we had a big question of, should we work as a region or a parish? And some other people said that they had some same kind of questions. So what are the benefits or the drawbacks of doing that? We didn't really have time to explore, but those were things that we were wondering about. So I did a little bit of work after with my group input, as well as the input from that February meeting, and a little bit more research. And we've been, my own group at my parish has been looking at these four categories as kind of things to keep in mind as we go forward, that there's a lot of desire to work on relationship building, like relationship within our parish with our group and with other people in the parish, but also relationship with local Indigenous groups. Awareness in terms of education. So, you know, learning more in the way of informing ourselves, but awareness also in terms of transformation. So learning more with the goal of living differently and being in relationship differently. And then advocacy and political action. And so we've talked a lot about what some of those options would be. So some of the ideas for the network that people had expressed at that last meeting, and then in some follow-up emails, why did people originally want to come together to share ideas like we've been doing today? Maybe to problem solve. Some people said they would really love like a go-to place of like, oh, I'm not getting a full, you know, registration, what should I do? Or, you know, people are dropping off from my group, what should I do? You know, like different things like that, that they felt that they would, it would be really great to have people as a kind of a sounding board to brainstorm together. You know, maybe we could come up with some really good advocacy plans, or, you know, maybe people would have some recommendations for how to watch a film together or things like that. Explore what's next. That's the whole action platform, like, we've done this program, what now? And just, you know, mutual support. Sometimes these sessions are hard. Sometimes things don't go well. Sometimes, you know, people have things that they feel that they would like to share with people who understand, and, you know, just to have a listening ear and to have encouragement. So those were the main reasons that were named by the group of why we'd want to come together as a network. A couple of big ones were named that we didn't touch at all, but there was this question about, you know, how do we all come to become facilitators? Do we have experience? Was there any training? And it was a mixed response. And I'm sorry for the kind of bluntness of this, but there was some discussion about quality control that people had shared, that, you know, they had varied experiences in their circles, depending on who was facilitating and what their own skill set was. So is that something that a network could help with somehow in providing resources or support, or maybe like apprenticeship facilitation or something like that? And then for us on the West Coast, there was a lot of talk as well about maybe a Western edition or supplements. I noticed in the chat that Kim had written that there's some Montreal resources for people who are doing this in the Montreal area. And so maybe that's something that we want to look at, not only for the West Coast, but also just for everywhere that people are doing it. Like, how do you connect more with information about your particular location? But for us in the western side of the country, there was a little bit more focus on this because a lot of the examples in the guide are like treaty focused, and you know, we don't have a long history of treaties here and things like that. So maybe just bring a little bit more diversity into the material. And then the other big question we had was listening to Indigenous voices as preparation for more. So that was how we did it in our parish. And I brought that to the group, and it just was, you know, stayed as a question I'd like to explore a little bit more. But when do we think about is the best time to hear from Indigenous speakers? Because again, people shared that there's mixed experiences with that. And maybe, you know, in terms of parish and the parish being able to really receive Indigenous well. And you know, I want to recognize what Joan was saying about the struggles in her parish about, you know, planning a smudge and then maybe not having everybody on board. So can listening to Indigenous voices be helpful as a way for people to move through that transformation experience and then maybe the receiving of kind of whatever's next will be different, will be smoother. So it was a question that we had about that. Not in a prescriptive way, but in a, could we make some kind of advice for people? Could we make some kind of recommendations? Could we help people kind of think this in a bigger picture of like a plan, like, oh, you start here and then move there. Again, not in a prescriptive way, but just in a helpful way for people who are like landing on this and just reading through the book for the first time. And so just to finish off here, we talked a little bit about if we were to meet as a group, and this was before I had connected with Trevor and before we thought that, you know, we could have some institutional support and things like that. But we talked about, you know, hey, if we met again, what would we do? And so we did commit as a group at that time that we would meet on Zoom 3 to 4 times a year and do something similar to what we had done last February. We also talked about maybe in-person regional meetings, like in the Vancouver area, there were quite a few of us that were on the call, and there were some people from the Ottawa area, from the Toronto area. So we thought, oh, well, you know, those people could meet maybe in person. And then Trevor and I had spoken maybe about having something on the website, on the Jesuit Forum website, as being the place to kind of house resources and ideas and maybe some kind of discussion. And would that be by password, or would that be open to the public, or would there be a bit of both? So those are some questions. A Facebook page has been proposed, and there could be other ideas that I would love to hear about from you all tonight in terms of like Slack is something that people sometimes use at work as a Facebook type discussion thing. There might be some other techie things that people can propose, or in-person things, etc. So thanks for your time. And this was meant, I think, just to get the conversation started. And so I'll turn it back to you, Trevor, where to go next.
Okay. Thank you so much, Monica. Wonderful. And thank you for the slides are helpful too. And we will request those from you, and then we can share them if you haven't done screen grabs already. But maybe just open it up. But any thoughts?
Mary is sharing in the chat, is suggesting a shared WhatsApp group.
Mm-hmm. Another. Mm-hmm.
Trevor, I don't know how to technically put my hand up, but may I speak?
Yeah. Yes.
I just listening to what everyone has been doing is so phenomenal. So I just thank God that so many people are doing this work without needing our parish priests, to be with us. But I just want to share our experience with a parish priest who is very supportive and almost leads us. And so before I even share anything, I know how well you trained the Jesuits, because they use the book Listening to Indigenous Voices. So I'm wondering if the next step is really working with parish priests, if that could be something that they might be open to. I don't know that. Mm-hmm. But as far as the using the book, we formed a circle and we called ourselves the Reconciliation Circle. And so we knew we wanted to not only learn, but also take action. And so our circle has only done three sessions. And we did those during, well, it was like our Lenten project for the parish. And we didn't necessarily stick to saying we have to do them during Lent. We went as far as June. So we spread the sessions apart. So it was our group, but then we invited the parish. And now we're getting to the point where we've made connections with other parishes. And the next event that is coming up, the notices are going out to the other parishes in our city, which is Kitchener. But some of the things that have happened because of our parish priest being on board, our diocese has donated some land for our Indigenous center that's in the city, and they're now using it to grow food. Like each year, we have planned a mass where the feast of Saint, I can't say it, Juan Diego, and we tell the story before mass, and then afterwards we have the three sister soup and bannock bread. So we're trying to learn some of the foods and also be together. For September 30th, that's Truth and Reconciliation Day, we met at the church and we did smudging. And then our goal was to walk with the people from Seven Generations to our town's park. We took too long with our smudging, so we didn't join up with them in the march, but we did meet them there. And we're working together with the separate school board and inviting students and staff and parishioners. We were about 200 people that went out for that day. And the one, like I could mention other things that have happened, but I'm trying to say is that if we could get our pastors and our priests involved where they start to believe in it as much as some of us do, I think things would, well, I think we could reach more people, probably is what I'm trying to say.
I fully agree, and that's a good idea to another means of keeping up the momentum and reaching new people. It's like we have to I hate to put it this way, but I'm going to, because sometimes we have to get through the gatekeepers of our parishes. It's very hard to, if we don't have their support, we're very limited. So thank you for emphasizing that, particularly those, of us who are part of faith communities. Carmela.
Yes, hi, thanks. So I'm Carmela Castellano Sinclair from Winnipeg. I'm the director of the St. Ignatius Spiritual Education Center. And I was invited through the provincial Jeff to come and just listen and observe. And Trevor, you look very familiar to me from your days, I guess, here at St. Ignatius many, many moons
Yes.
ago. Yeah, 20 years, 20 years ago or so for a brief period.
Oh my God, I see that.
Right. And so I just want to say thank you. I've really appreciated all of the sharing, and it's expanded my understanding of how this resource is being used, this educational tool. I know here at our local level, the Archdiocese has taken that on, and they actually have a position assigned to somebody who has been over the few years running the listening circles and learning circles. What we've done specifically at St. Ignatius, actually, I'm just going to maybe stick to future pieces. I want to concur that relationship building has been the umbrella goal for us. And then everything else has fallen underneath that. And so that's kind of our mission, that's our goal. How do we build community with Indigenous communities in our area? And some of that is about educating our own population at the parish and our community so that they're ready to meet the other, so to speak. The other part of it has been meeting with survivors of residential schools, Indigenous people who are ready to make that connection. And they've already been doing their work in terms of healing and preparing themselves for dialogue. And so over the last couple of years, it's been about bringing each group together in learning, listening, and dialoguing. And so our format looks like we bring in a speaker. Now, I have to say, it started like in 2016, long before I became the director of the center, and they were small numbers. They started with usually 20 people, and there'd be a connection with an Indigenous community, and we would take turns, meaning our parishioners would go to their location. There'd be a guest speaker, a learning, a listening together, and then breaking out into dialogue circles where we would mix our groups up and listen and learn, and relationships have built. So we've learned about each other, where the pain has been, where the pain still is, and just hold space for that. And it seems to have been working as a pretty powerful tool. Like our last event had 120 people. We had like 70% Indigenous people. Part of it is getting a topic. I heard about engagement, people feeling fatigued. These are like, we maybe host four events a year, two at St. Ignatius and then two offsite into the community. And our sister parish helps facilitate that, which is St. Catherine, and it is our Indigenous Catholic parish in the core area. And we come together on topics that are relevant, that tend to inspire people to come out. So for example, Rooster Town. So we are on a Métis settlement here at St. Ignatius, and Rooster Town was a Métis settlement that by the 1960s, it was a Métis built community and was bulldozed out. And many of those people who lived there, their kids went to St. Ignatius School, and some of them attended the parish, and it was bulldozed down to build a mall. And there was history, but people didn't even know their own history. Like even people in our communities that live in the residential area didn't know their history. And we had like 70% Indigenous people, many of them Métis, coming, going, wow, that makes sense. And bringing in professors, leaders in the Indigenous community who also have a following of young seekers and learners that want to commit themselves to healing. So it's kind of like, we talk about cast the nets where there are fish, because it gets really exhausting. We found when we are trying to create something where there isn't energy. And so we just shifted our energy a little bit by saying the brainstorming, which was so wisely suggested. What is the goal? What is a real goal? And for us, it comes down to relationship building, and then we work our way backwards. How do we do that? How do we come together? So we have what's called learning and dialogue circles. So we bring in, and they're short and they're sweet in the sense that they're a 2-hour event, but maybe in the whole year, 4 times we have groups come together, sometimes as much as 6 for 2 hours. And people get very excited, I think, on the Catholic side, non-Indigenous side, to meet Indigenous people and to really hold space for even our own shame, right? Of being part of a faith community that caused this harm, right? And to be so, it's so powerful to say, wow, the community trusts us to come out, and not everybody does, but to come and share their stories with us. And we learn together and then reflect on the learning. Anyway, I just wanted to say that. So when you go, when I think too about our group, where do we go from here? It's whatever new way that we can help to build relations. Sometimes it's celebrating Indigenous community and people and culture and language. Other times it's money, because simply money talk. How can we? So we created a group with our Catholic schools and our students. We're doing fundraisers specifically where they would research a community that they wanted to get in touch with and learn more about. And for us, it was, where is it here? The Saikin community, First Nation community. And we did fundraising at the Catholic school level. And it was a part of the parents getting involved saying, yep, I send my children to a Catholic school that was, you know, historically a part of the oppression, right? And the aim of genocide and wiping out a community. And yet I choose to send my children to Catholic. So I now need to educate myself. What am I really saying yes to here? So it's an opportunity for parents to be educated, contribute to the fundraising because of the privilege that they experience being who they are. And then we donated the funds to their Turtle Lodge, and were invited to go be a part of their sacred bundle ceremony. And so just looking for creative ways to continue to build relationship. If you go to our website and you're ever curious, at St. Ignatius, stingingnations.ca, and go to our Truth and Reconciliation page. There's some information there about some of the things that we've done. But okay. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Carmela. Yeah.
You bet.
So we have 5 more minutes. So maybe we'll begin to wrap up, but maybe Kim had her hand up, and then we'll conclude with, in terms of people with hands up, we'll conclude with Kim. And then we'll have a looking forward. So, Kim, you don't have your hand up anymore. But
good evening. Thank you. Thank you for this evening. It's great to see some familiar faces and to see yours, Trevor, because we talked a lot, but we never met. So thank you. It's great to meet you. I just wanted to briefly address one of the points was modifications of the 11 sessions. And I feel kind of funny saying this in such a diverse group tonight across Canada. But I guess I can speak for a group that I helped set up in Montreal, west of Montreal. I think some of the facilitators are here tonight. But I wanted to say that my experience of setting it up and kind of accompanying them, but behind the scenes, I wasn't the facilitator, was that I got a fair bit of flack at the beginning from my colleagues about, well, you know, nothing about us without us. And we didn't have like an Indigenous person accompanying us. I had thought of inviting somebody to just sort of accompany us, but we didn't, and we ended up not doing that. And I think that it was wise, because the way I saw it was the sessions themselves were preparing us to be in a place to dialogue. We weren't ready for dialogue. And that's assuming that we would have some willing dialogue partners, because we just didn't know enough. And it became clear to me during the course of the sessions, because we would always plug in a blanket exercise, and then there would be some Indigenous voices in the facilitating team of the Indigenous blanket exercises. But, you know, some of the questions, it was very early in the sessions. It was like, I think, after the first or second session. And some of the comments that people made to the Indigenous peoples on the team reflected back to me. It confirmed for me that we're just not ready for dialogue, you know. And for example, one question was, oh, we'd like you to come back and talk about, you know, your experience in residential schools or somebody else's that you knew, you know. And I kind of cringed, because it was like, well, you know, we have the truth and reconciliation testimonies and report before us, you know. And I think Indigenous peoples appreciate when we do the work and the effort, just like so many of you here are doing, before we just invite, you know. I think that it goes towards relationship building, you know, like mm-hmm. somebody else said. And I have a feeling that, you know, the people that are going through the sessions are being formed, and I don't know, I know that many of you have done it differently, but my experience is that let's get formed. And then maybe we're in a place to reach out to communities the woman who just came before me mentioned. That's a pretty amazing way to be doing it, and focusing on the relationship building first and the formation, but making sure that, you know, you're engaging in appropriate dialogue. Let's put it that way. Mm-hmm. Thanks. Okay.
Thank you so much, Kim. So I'll just say a few concluding remarks, and then I'll invite Angela to offer anything that she would kind of leave with some of Angela's thoughts, if that's not putting too much pressure on her. But I just was, you know, thank you everyone for your sharing. There's, we're going to go a little bit over time, just 5 minutes at the most. So stick with us. And just clearly there's a lot of energy, you know, the fact that we're going over a little bit of overtime, that there's a need for further coming together, you know, such as a Listen to Indigenous Voices national network. And I know that we have people here from all across the country, from the East Coast to the West Coast and points in between. So it's clearly a national interest. So, you know, Monica brought up so many good points that we could meet on one of them, and then another one, you know, quality control, facilitator training. There is the question of some sharing groups. They're not as fruitful maybe because of you know, the different degrees of facilitation. So offering further training on how to organize, listening to Indigenous Voices dialogue series, how to facilitate small groups and so on. So that's something that we will look at offering. And I want to emphasize this I assume that there's interest in a network, but for a network to succeed, we need volunteers, we need leadership. so we'll be putting out, so we will be working towards that and communicating with everyone. So I just want to end with that. It's just the beginning of a conversation. And we look forward to, you know, to reaching out and coming together in thematic ways in the coming months ahead. And so with that, Angela, I sort of overwhelm you with any thoughts, encouragement, wisdom that you'd like to share with us as we conclude?
Well, I guess I just want to, everything that's been brought to the space today, these are all like your intention is good, and I think that's the most important thing is your intention. And moving forward, it's just that connection and use talking and bringing to building about that bridge from for use together, but all that bridge to the Indigenous community is going to be ultimately the most important. But that brainstorm, I think, is ultimately going to help use with your vision, because these are going to see all the steps that need to happen. But I wish you all the best. I enjoyed it. I think it's important. It's work that's never going to end, but use each of you that are stepping forward to do this work. Sometimes it's heavy. Sometimes it's, but it's rewarding in the end, because as much as you step forward to create these relationships and build these relationships with us, just as much as you help us heal and yous also heal, like we all heal. We're all here to learn, to let go, to grow, and to move forward with each other. And I think that's where it would be nice to have the leaders of the churches, because I think that's a kind of setting a precedence, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's important. But the most important thing is yous are here to create change, and that's. That's the most important thing. So Chimigwech, thank you for having me tonight. And Joan knows I'm only a call away anytime you need anything. So thank you so much.
Chimigwech, thank you so much, Angela, for being with us, and for Joan and Monica for offering us extended input and sharing of your ideas and experiences. So, and to Stan and Victor for the background. And thank you, everyone. And we'll be in touch. Mm-hmm.